station.
Whatever, Scotty Pizza.
Welcome to Fort Fritz, your one-stop shop for all things relating to the supernatural, the paranormal, the Fortean, and things that go whoop, bump in the night, all packaged and presented in the form of know-nothing know-it-alls entertaining the unknown. Hello, I am your host, Fritz, joined as always by co-host Mandaddy.
Hi.
Kaz.
Hey, howdy.
And Angela.
Hello.
So, I just posted some videos at realradio.fm. They show a ghost in a music store.
Ooh.
Several videos, two of them actually. And also, things flying off the shelf in a liquor store, a tavern actually, in England. It's the Ye Old Shambles Tavern.
Ye Old Shambles?
Ye Old Shambles.
Wow.
Got
That's
trashed
a great
by a ghost.
Name. I want to go there so bad.
All about it.
And gift shop.
Perfect. Yes.
So you check that out, realradio.fm. Just click shows and blogs. But, lady and gentlemen, we have a lot more important things to discuss. Docs show that the Navy have a UFO patent granted by, and they got this UFO patent granted by warning of similar Chinese tech advances. This is by Tyler Rogaway, who is our boy from The Drive. This is on thedrive.com/thewarzone.
All right.
It shows a cone, you know, this diamond-looking aircraft, but on the sides, it looks, because it's also, so think of this pyramid, but then when you put it flat, I guess that would be the X-axis?
Sure.
It has a cone coming from the tops and bottom, so it would look almost spherically round, and this is really, really crazy, because they are saying that they got this because the Chinese are already trying to patent this damn thing. So the UF patent office denied it several times until someone had to reach out and say, look, if the Chinese gets to this technology first, then we are all going to be paying them in perpetuity forever. And then they finally relented, and that was in October 2018.
So what makes this design unique? What is it that, what is the need to have this?
Well, Tyler from the drive.com article says he reached out to a physicist, and it gets even more complex, but it's the craft is able to engineer the fabric of our reality at the most fundamental level by exploiting the laws of physics.
Could you be more vague?
Exploiting.
Right.
It does cool stuff and things happen.
Yikes.
It's a curiously shaped, quote, high frequency gravitational wave generator.
Mm.
Which
this really sounds like what I'm going to be talking about later and what we've talked about in the past.
This is really just crazy stuff.
Wow.
It's a room temperature superconductor.
What?
And electromagnetic force field generator that could deflect asteroids. And perhaps the strangest of all from the article, one titled Craft Using an Inertial Mass Reduction Device. So this thing could have a force field generator. If you have ever seen pictures of UFOs, some of them have a little blurred outline around the entire shape.
Mm-hmm.
A little glimmer.
Yep. So this craft could be underwater, come out of the water, fly in our atmosphere, and woo, go right into outer space.
Wow.
Oh, whoa.
It's so, let me see if I can break this down.
It's that whole force field thing that we've always been trying to work on. Is that force field?
Exactly.
Fields and teleportation.
Boom.
And lasers.
Yeah.
That's like the trifecta.
We got the lasers. We got lasers. So now we just need
like
two others.
I want like a Star Trekian laser, though.
Like a handheld kill bill. Yeah, okay.
Teleportation is definitely Charles Fortean, you know, but this. So if you can, A, create a room temperature superconductor capable
That's
of
crazy
storing.
Right there.
Yeah. Capable. Because magnets usually
well,
work
who's
at
room
like,
temperature? Because I like a nice like 72, 73. I'm cool.
Yeah,
I got
like
a nice pool.
Yeah, it's like 78 in here.
That's all relative.
It is, right?
Yeah.
So if you can create a room temperature superconductor capable of storing an incredibly high amount of energy, and B, get the energy field created by that superconductor moving at incredibly high speeds around or within the craft, you can create a polarized energy vacuum around it, which allows it to basically ignore the energy of the air or water around it, thereby removing its own inertia and mass from the equation.
That's messed up.
So you just like take off with like very minimal force or propulsion.
So you could drive this thing right at a Mandaddy, and Mandaddy would just go, oh, and it would just go, oh,
just, that happens all the time.
It would, push you away from it.
No, it wouldn't.
You would. It wouldn't hit you.
Bring it,
dude. It would just kind of take you and just toss you aside.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It would blow past you.
No, it wouldn't. I'd take that UFO down.
So, this is the HAUC. It's conical in configuration with an elliptical cross section, similar in geometry to a hypersonic glide vehicle or a dart, and it even has in the drawing patent. A room for a crew compartment shielded by a Faraday cage. Does anyone know what that is?
Yeah, that keeps all electromagnetic waves out or in.
Because that would interfere with the propulsion system.
Yeah. A lot of movie theaters are actually putting Faraday cages in the movie theater so people can't use their phones.
That is really good. That's a good idea.
Yeah.
Kind of like a radio frequency jammer,
yep,
RF
basically.
Jammer. So I thought that was really, really cool. This is the capabilities described in the paper. And Tyler, from, again, the Drive.com article, it should sound familiar to anyone who's been following the Navy UFO stories over the last several years. It is possible to envision hybrid aerospace undersea craft. That's what the HAUC stands for, hybrid aerospace undersea craft, which can function as a submersible craft, capable of extreme underwater speeds, lack of water skin friction, and enhanced aerial underwater stealth capabilities, nonlinear scattering of RF and sonar signals. This hybrid craft would move with great ease through the airspace water mediums by being enclosed in a vacuum plasma bubble sheath. Due to the coupled effects of EM, electromagnetic field-induced air-water particles, repulsion, and vacuum energy polarization.
What?
We're really, really broadcasting with this one. Really getting all the people in this
so,
net.
All the science. all the science.
Exactly. Everyone loves technical science terms.
So Tyler went to his buddy, Dr. Brian Collette, a Hamilton College physics chair, and he said the claims of the HAUC, quote, bear no more resemblance to quantum physics, as I understand it, than does the force from Star Wars, unquote.
Yes.
He even says, moreover, quote, a working room temperature superconductor would have far more radical uses that are actually within the bounds of possibility, unquote, than a hybrid craft that can theoretically create a quantum vacuum around itself. What do you think?
It sounds like it's like the space race in a way,
yeah.
but alien race. We're like the technology has gotten to Earth. All the countries have it, and we're all trying to utilize it. You know, I mean, that's what it seems like. It's all kind of similar. And so it makes you wonder, have we been just visited by one species that has one technology, or is there possibly multiple technology from multiple alien species?
Isn't that the plot of Battleground Earth with John Travolta and...
God, I would never
watch Battlefield Earth.
Yes.
I didn't watch it either, but I'm like, just going by the like name and what you were just describing, it sounds like...
Oh, well, I mean, that's all his L. Ron Hubbard, you know, fetish thing. That was like his main thing, so that was his favorite L. Ron Hubbard novels, to do Battlefield Earth, and... It didn't do well. It's listed everywhere as one of the worst movies of all time.
Yeah. Cash is like, doesn't this remind you of Battlefield Earth? And then everyone goes, I haven't seen it. He's like, yeah, no,
yeah,
I haven't
seen
it. I don't know. So,
just bringing up conversation, people.
This was denied three times by just saying it's impossible with today's technology to create the insane amount of energy needed to generate the EM field that would propel this craft in the manner described. But then again, the government gets involved and just says, just push it through. So they did. So there you go. That's going to be a game changer. If any country comes up with it and USA is trying to patent that. We now go to telepathic games, medicaldaily.com. Scientists achieve first brain to brain connection.
Uh-huh.
What?
Yep. From the article, humans may soon talk and connect to each other and their devices with just their minds. For the first time, scientists have demonstrated the first brain-to-brain network that allowed more than two people to receive and send information in a manner similar to telepathy. So,
ooh,
if we think Facebook is a problem, this thing's really going to be a problem.
Oh,
yeah.
Man. See, in Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, they say that one of the worst things you can inflict on a planet is telepathy.
Yep.
Because everyone now is broadcasting all their thoughts to everyone within a half a mile. And so when you inflict a planet with that, everyone just starts thinking of the most, or saying the most inane things to keep their brain from functioning. So they're just talking about the weather, talking about the room, and it's just small talk, small talk, small talk, and makes the planet completely annoying. Yep. So that's how you inflict pain on a planet, is you give them telepathy.
Yeah. Absolutely. So this demonstration... Rajesh Rowell, a professor in the UW's Paul G. Allen School of Computer Science and Engineering, said, quote, "We wanted to know if a group of people could collaborate using only their brains," unquote. So they assigned two people to be senders and one user to be the receiver, so three people, while playing the Tetris-inspired game, this game that they came up with. Senders can see both the block and the line, but are not allowed to control this game. But the receiver can control the game, but can't see the line. So... they transmitted from their brain through the internet and to the brain of the receiver. The results showed, and this was published in the journal Scientific Reports, showed that the three players were able to link their minds and complete the game without talking or seeing each other.
That's messed up.
That is crazy.
So basically they would think like, okay, this is a straight line, and he'd know that a straight line's coming, and or if it was an L line or whatever.
That is exactly correct.
Really? And no no diodes or anything like that? This was just nothing connected?
They had this, like, the little...
Cerebro?
Yeah, it's the thing with what got the plugs.
The shower cap with the plugs.
Yeah,
these technical terms, once again, these technical terms, man.
Yeah, it looks like a shower cap or, you know, like synchronized swimming, you know? The what is that? It's not a skull cap. What is it?
A swim cap.
Swim cap. Hmm. But it's got diodes in it. They were able to trick neurons in the brain to spread the message. So, I guess keep your eye out on that. From the article, quote, "This coil in the diode stimulates the part of the brain that translates signals from the eyes." So they're pretty much mind hacking.
So, so it's not really telepathy. It's just kind of reading what the brain is doing and then sending it. Telepathy, I mean, if they're not wearing anything and there's,
yeah,
then that's telepathy. This is just like, this is just interpreting what the brain is doing,
okay,
basically.
Okay, well, it's step one.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Is that not amazing to you?
Yeah, he wants teleportation. I want real telepathy. What's wrong with that?
Did you just curse?
No.
Oh, because I can dump you.
No, I didn't. Did I curse?
I don't think
no.
so.
Yeah,
I will.
No.
I'm good
you
at
need
it.
Need me to. I got plenty.
Finally, we end with the most terrifying story of all. 53,000 people have pledged to, quote, storm Area 51 this fall.
How many?
53,000.
53K? This well, is... all right, I'm peeing on this.
Well, no, sounds like you got to think about it. If it's a Facebook event, if it says 53,000, that means it's going to be 200.
Well, this is this is published on mysteriousuniverse.org. Oh, but Cass, think about it. If you get arrested, you go to space prison.
Oh, my
there
God.
You go.
Oh,
yes. There's your intro to space prison, man.
There you go.
So, from Mysterious Universe,
one man, one mission to enter space prison, only to exit space prison.
This is, this was posted to Facebook.
So it is a Facebook.
Yep. And the group, quote, S posting, because I'm in shambles, unquote, created the event. Titled Storm Area 51, They Can't Stop All of Us. And you can, if you're on.
It's true.
I love
it's
true.
That's a good battle cry. Yep.
And I'm gonna go ahead and click on that.
They can't stop all of us! Someone's like, wait, what? No. So they can stop some of us?
From the Facebook page, we will all meet up at the Area 51 Alien Center tourist attraction and coordinate our entry.
That's so crazy.
If we Naruto run, we can move faster than their bullets. Let's see them aliens.
Oh, right. They brought up a Naruto.
Get out.
So Storm Area 51, they can't stop all of us. Let's see how many people are going.
I want to see people coordinate. Like, okay, who's bringing snacks? I got ice. Who's going to...
That's the most important part.
The most amazing tailgate outside of Area 51 before the storming. You know, nothing but brats and craziness.
Oh, my God. It's now updated. As of July 8th, over 120,000 people have now said they will attend.
It's going to be 58 guys.
But still, let's just say 10 or 9% showed up. That would still be a lot. This is a bad idea, people.
It's a bad idea.
If you're listening right here to Real Radio 104.1, please do not do this. Your life is worth more than this. Please, please do not do this.
I'd like to know what the numbers are on this versus the Keystone Pipeline check-in.
Right.
Compare and contrast.
People interested in the Area 51.
Here's the thing. If these people want to find out if our government has death lasers, this is the way to find out if they have death lasers. Just have 100,000 people charge, and we'll find out.
Yeah, you are definitely going to find out from that. Well, coming up, Mandaddy is going to tell us all about the Hellboy movie and the Bob Lazar doc on Netflix. Kaz is going to tell us about Lord of the Rings. That's an Amazon TV show, right?
Yeah.
And Angela will give her review on Stranger Things Season 3. Have you watched all of it?
Oh, yeah.
Of course she has.
Right. Well, don't go anywhere.
Three times.
You're listening to Fort Fritz on Real Radio 104.1. Fritz?
Point one. Saying who that there, hey, everywhere
we go, everywhere we go, everywhere we go. Welcome back to Fort Fritz. We have our fearless host over there behind the board today.
Yellow.
Fritz. Our co-host, Mandaddy.
Hi.
As always, Angela.
Hello.
And I am your fearless follower, Kaz.
That's right.
We've actually got some social media plugs to go over really quickly, so we are going to direct that to
Fritz. Fritz, tell the people how they can get in contact with us on social media.
Let's see, as fast as I can. Facebook, at Fort Fritz. Twitter, at Fort Fritz, capital MCT. Instagram is at Fort Fritz. iHeartMedia app or iHeartRadio app, download that. Search Fort Fritz, FORTE, FRITZE, and you can hear all about our crazy endeavors into the lands of the unknown, the future, the past, underwater, and outer space. You name it, we've done it. We're even trapped in a 4K TV right now, but I've said too much. It's an audio drama. That's all you need to know. And on that note, I am done talking about Fort Fritz.
So we've been getting some movie reviews all night from you, but you have a couple specific that you wanted to go over. What do you got for us, Mandaddy?
Yeah, I got a few movies. One pretty enjoyable and one disappointing. I'll start off with the disappointing one, and it's the new Hellboy. The new Hellboy with Hopper playing Hellboy.
Yep, David Harbour.
And I had high hopes for it. It was an R-rated. And it's I guess a reboot because you already had the two really good ones by Guillermo del Toro, Hellboy 1 and 2, Hellboy 2, The Golden Army, which, by the way, The Golden Army I still think is one of the most visually amazing films.
They were
films.
Both really cool.
The first one was great too, but the second one just visually, I thought you could tell the budget was a little up there. And when you got these two movies told by, and Guillermo del Toro is a master storyteller.
Yes, he is.
And whoever did this is not a master storyteller.
Do we know who that is?
I can't think of his name. I can't think of what he did. It's just a mess. It was a real mess. The Hellboy look, I didn't mind. The face was a little gnarled. I mean, I know they're trying to make it look how the comic had. The comic had like a black, blocky kind of style to it. But the hair, something about his hair, I couldn't stand the way Hellboy's hair looked. I know that's such a minor thing, and it's not going to change whether you enjoy the movie or not, but his hair was just so greasy.
Well, if it pisses you off, then it pisses you off.
It pisses me off.
It was directed by Neil Marshall.
Right.
He's directed a bunch of Game of Thrones episodes. Actually, really good Game of Thrones episodes.
Oh, he's better with the short form than long form, though. Yeah.
And Andrew Cosby wrote the screenplay.
It was just disappointing. They tried to lean into the R thing, and so there's a lot more gore and a lot of CGI gore. So there's plenty of people being ripped apart, lots of intestines flying all over the place, and that's all cool. But some of the CGI, is so bad.
Oh, God.
And here's where it really came, and it made me think of the whole problem with Game of Thrones when it came to why Jon Snow didn't pet Ghost. Because having a human being interact with CGI is difficult to make it look real. And so you have decent CGI throughout the movie, and then there's these... then there's these scenes where Hellboy is fighting these giants. And there's these giant CGI giants, and you got Hellboy wearing his makeup and fighting them, and it just looked so bad. It looked like old Sinbad movies, like when they're interacting.
Sinbad bad?
Yeah, like when they're interacting with stop-motion skeletons. It almost had that. It took you out of it almost that much.
Why are we pooping all over Sinbad? I like Sinbad.
I love that stuff, but that was also in the 60s and 70s, you know?
That movie where he had to take care of, like, the president's son or something?
No, I'm talking about Sinbad the Sailor, man. Come on. Get on board. You do know that Sinbad was a sailor, like a mythical sailor, not just
a sailor or a pirate?
No, he was more of a sailor. He was a good guy, so he wasn't really a pirate. He fought like Medusa and skeletons and stuff like that.
Did he win?
Oh God, yeah, all the time. That's what he did, man.
I thought he was a comedian actor.
Yeah,
I'll be honest.
He was more like the windbreakers and stuff.
Oh God. I'm dealing with children.
I forgot about the windbreakers.
He did have a lot of windbreakers.
You started, right. You're all about Oliver Tree. You don't know about windbreakers.
Oh, I know a lot more about windbreakers than you do, man. I grew up in windbreakers.
I was born into a windbreaker. I was swaddled in a windbreaker.
But it was just really a mess. I mean, I like the first two. Of course, this has nothing to do with the first two. It's just a bit of a mess. And so I'd give it maybe, I don't know, 3 beard pulls. I'll give it 3 Mandaddy beard pulls.
Out of 7?
Out of 7. I'll give it 3. Maybe that's 4 on a good day. 4, you know, 4 after a 12-pack maybe, you know. But it just go back and watch the first two and dream of what could be.
Were there good performances at least?
I didn't mind him as Hellboy.
Yeah.
But it's just, he was just given bad quips, you know, and it was a lot of stupid one-liners, and it just, you know, the first two movies are, I mean, I keep on saying the first two movies, the two movies that have nothing to do with this, just had such a better character work, the team worked so much better together with Abe Sapien and all that, and you get just a glimpse of Abe Sapien near the end. It's just the first two just pluke this movie so hard. It's just, the first two are so much better.
What was that?
So a 3 out of 7?
Yeah, I'll give that 3 out of 7.
And this one's pluked.
That one is totally pluked. That one is pluked as pluked could be. It's totally pluked. Get into Frank Zappa. So, but a good movie to check out, especially if you're into our show and what we're down with, it's called Bob Lazar, Area 51 and Flying Saucers, and it's on Netflix. And it's a fun documentary about a guy that came out in 1988 saying that, look, I worked at a place called S1 or something like that, that was connected to Area 51. And so it was like some of the first, like, things that popularized Area 51 was this guy, Bob Lazar, going on the news and saying what he has seen. And after that, he, of course, became a pariah. But he stuck to his story for 30 years about what he saw in Area 51, the type of stuff he was dealing with. And a lot of the stuff that he gets into in the movie reminded me of, what was the name of the guy that we interviewed?
Oh, God, I don't know.
What was his code name?
Jake the Snake.
Oh, the guy that we interviewed, that was Red Fox.
Elizabeth!
Nice.
He was a great guy that came in and told us stories of stuff that he had seen at Area 51. And a lot of the stuff that Bob Lazar talked about really kind of interconnected with what he talked about, like the Wave Runner, the ship that, you know, kind of used sonic booms to ride them like waves. He talks about that, but in a different way, almost very similar to the object you were talking about at the beginning of the show, that kind of pokes a hole in reality and goes through it. And that's kind of the way it transverses. That's how these UFOs do.
Yeah, Red Fox, this was on a podcast that Mandaddy and I were on previously, but he was stationed at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base. And I was like, is there anything in Hangar 18 that's like a legendary hangar in ufology lore where there is a dead alien? And he said, no, there's nothing in Hangar 18. He goes, however. And then we're like, yeah.
It was a fun interview. It really is.
Here's a little bit of the trailer, just if you guys want to hear a little bit of it. It's very spooky.
This story is extraordinary, especially if it's true.
That right there is the problem.
It started in the desert, just north of Las Vegas.
A local scientist,
I love this guy's voice,
worked at Groom Lake,
said to be where top secret weapons systems have been tested over the years.
That's spooky.
And that's the problem with the movie. The one problem with the movie is the movie could be about 30 minutes shorter, but throughout the movie are all these long, like metaphysical rants by,
just then he thought about, what type of reality is there? Are there two realities? The reality we're existing in and the reality that we dream in.
Is that Bob Lazar?
And no, it's all Mickey Rourke. Oh. It's Mickey Rourke.
Oh.
And that's how they got like people into the movie. They're like, oh, we got Mickey Rourke on it. But you could take him out of the movie. And it's just a way better movie, a way better narrative. It's just every so often just, and then one day the stars
shirt
align.
On the whole movie?
What?
Does he keep the shirt on the whole movie?
Well, you just hear him. You just hear him, so probably not. Oh. So I'm guessing his shirt's completely
shirtless
off. Completely. Yeah, completely. And his face. He's got one of those faces
Craggy.
That's like, it's like non-Euclidean geometry. It doesn't make sense. You have to look at it, you know, like through a mirror to understand it.
They don't make
it.
Faces like that.
They don't. They shouldn't.
Craggy face. Yeah, no, it's classic.
But if you're into UFO lore and everything, it's a very good documentary. And like one of the things that he talks about, like he always talked about that when he walked into the facility, there's this biometric scanner that you put your hand on that shone lights through it and that it used the distance between your bones to identify you.
He got
you.
That from Men in Black. Come on.
That was in Gattaca.
Ooh, I forgot about Gattaca. That's a good movie.
Space Prison. Isn't there a space prison in Gattaca, I think? Something similar?
Probably.
Space Detention. Yeah. Kind of like...
Space
it's not as cool, and they let you go home at the end
eventually,
of the day.
Yeah.
Can I stay?
You get to hang out with Ethan Hawke.
Space day camp, basically.
Oh, that's
but terrible. So he always talked about this biometric scanner, and no one believed him. They're like, no, we don't have that, you know, in 1988. That never happened. And then finally, some stuff through government, like, you know, the Sunshine Law or something like that, where they got a picture of the scanner, and they showed it to him, and then that was the first time he's seen it since 1980. He's like, there it is. He's like, that's exactly what I described. And he was blown away that to see a picture of that biometric scanner that he's been talking about since 88, that no one believed him. And then finally, we have pictures that confirm at least that part of his story. So it's really fun, Doc, for that very reason.
I have a Bob Lazar...
trading card?
No, modeled tester flying saucer that was hanging in my home studio that, like, fell apart because the glue that I used wouldn't hold it or whatever, but it's that classic UFO shape that you see in the I Want to Believe poster.
Yep, the saucer.
The only bad thing about Bob Lazar is that no one believes him.
I want to believe.
He's just one of those, like, yeah, shut up, Bob.
Well, now he's got the backing of Mickey Rourke, right?
Right, like, yeah,
somewhere,
the power.
Whose face is
shirtless
craggy.
Mickey Rourke, craggy face, craggy. Dark room, candle, you know, he's just, like, in a mic.
Dark room and a candle.
Yeah.
Shirt off.
That's how he records.
Shirt off.
Shirtless.
Shirtless, candle,
shirtless,
it's
candle.
All there. You could hear
just hear
it.
The glistening?
Hear. Oh, yeah.
Who said anything about glistening?
She assumed there'd be glistening. He's got his shirt off. It's Mickey Rourke. He's in candlelight. There's going to be glistening.
Yeah, I don't think there's a fan on. It's probably stifling in there.
Knowing Mickey Rourke, yeah, he's going to stifle that room.
He's got sweat in the craggies.
All right, so right up in them craggies.
You got sweat in the old craggies, my man.
The Bob, what is it called again?
It's called, yeah.
I mean, I can just tell you if you want. Bob Lazar, colon. Area
called,
51
yeah, Bob
and Flying
Lazar,
Saucers.
Yeah, Bob Lazar, Area 51 and Flying Saucers on Netflix.
So out of 7 beard pulls.
Out of 7, I'd give it a solid 5. You know, I mean, I'd give it a 5.5 if you took Mickey Rourke's ramblings out of it. No, no dissing to Mickey Rourke. The man's a genius and an American treasure, because I'm going to say that appeal. Yeah, it'll destroy me into dust. But it's a good documentary if you're into the Area 51, if you're into UFO folklore. It's got a lot of stuff in there that's going to make you go, wait a minute, it just shows a lot of parallel lines of the stuff that we've all heard before and makes you wonder if this is just confirmation of what we thought.
It's really scary. So, Bob.
Dope.
Bob Lazar.
That's why we do that at the court.
I didn't have my.
Yeah, that's really scary.
I didn't have my mic on, so a little behind the scenes for you. As I was fading down on the music, a Fender ad pops up, and I go, ooh, Fender. And I was like, well, that's interesting, Matt. That's really scary. It's like, son of a bitch. I had
a great
segue.
Fritz. I had the prize, Fritz.
I had a great segue.
Had.
So, yeah, had. Yeah, sure. Coming up, Kaz will tell us all about the Lord of the Rings Amazon TV show. Is that upcoming?
It is upcoming.
So it's a planned release?
Planned release.
Oh, well, Kaz has all the dirt on that one. And Angela has seen Stranger Things Season 3 9 times. She's going to tell us all about it. Don't go anywhere. You are listening to Fort Fritz on Real Radio 104.1.
Doors down so you can't ignore it. I'll hunt you down like a Tyrannosaurus. My teeth are sharp like a great white shark. Let me taste that flesh. It's my favorite part. Got an eagle beak with the ostrich feet. 7 spider eyes for every day of the week.
4.1.
There it is. Welcome back to Fort Fritz. I am Fritz, joined as always by co-host Mandaddy.
Hi.
Kaz.
Hey.
And now Angela is going to tell us all about Stranger Things Season 3. Hey, Angela.
Glad you could make it. She just ran in the door right there.
Yeah. How are you?
I'm doing well.
So you've seen Stranger Things, which came out, what, July 3rd? You've seen it 3 times already?
It was the 4th. I think it came out on the 4th. Yes.
Well, please tell us all about it.
I think it was the best season out of all 3 seasons.
I'm almost done, and it's been amazing. It's been so much fun.
Nice.
Good. The kids are so grown up now.
Uh-huh. The scariest thing is Mike's legs. Mike's legs are creepy. They're like
long,
tiny, white. Like,
actually, both Mike and Will They just look like someone just stretched them.
That's fun with hormones.
That's good, right? Or no?
Huh?
Is that good or
it's
bad?
It's creepy.
Yeah. It's creepy. Also, some voice changes with some of the boys. I would say, again, Mike and Will, were, like for the first two seasons, had those younger voices still. But then this season three, they both, like, their voices changed. And even, like, trying to not, like, if you're not watching it, you're just, like, in the house doing something. I could not tell who they were. I'm like, I don't recognize their voices anymore.
That
who
sucks.
Are you, child?
Yeah, that's to the detriment of this season then, right, would you say?
It's weird. No, it was definitely weird, and it was something to get used to for the first couple of episodes. For me, personally.
It didn't take me out of it. I mean, it's going to happen. You know?
Of course. Yeah. I mean,
Will is walking trauma. Just everything, every time you look at him, you just get tense.
That poor child.
Yeah.
That poor child. And all he wanted to do is play D&D.
All he wants to do.
All Will wants to do is play D&D, but everyone's got girlfriends now, and they're all getting older. And that's the other thing. They're kind of growing out of some things, and things are changing. The dynamic of the group's changing. But it was such a joy to watch. I think I woke up on Thursday at 6 a.m., and started watching it. And every season has 8 to 9 episodes, and they're all about an hour long. And we're having a little shindig at the house at around 3 o'clock, and I think we had to stop watching it at episode 5 and then get ready for the party.
So that was 5 hours straight then?
Of just watching this.
The day that it came out?
Yes, the day that it came out. And I've watched it 3 times completely since.
So are there any, without giving anything away, do you have a favorite episode?
Ooh, a favorite episode.
No spoilers.
I know, that's kind of hard. I would say probably the 7th episode is really great.
7th?
Yeah.
Is it the penultimate?
That's the penultimate.
Yeah, the penultimate.
That's what we're watching tonight.
Yeah, it's really good.
With TV series, that's a main thing. Have you noticed it's always the penultimate episode? The climax episode is not the final. It's the penultimate.
Right.
And then the second episode is the denouement, where it has the falling action.
Right. Well, yeah, because that last episode's kind of the wrap-up. A little bit of everything. The monster is I would say my warning when watching this this season, don't eat while watching it.
It's kind of gross.
Pretty disgusting.
A lot of goo.
It's a lot of goo. And I actually rewatching seasons 1 and 2, those were pretty gooey. The gate's disgusting. It's very organic and it's got goo and stringy,
yeah,
and it's just very disgusting looking and slimy,
yeah.
It's
very John Carpenter, the thing,
yes.
And who did Videodrome? Cronenberg, a lot of
David
Cronenberg,
yeah.
You know, a lot of gooey.
I would say they do a good job of making it that 80s horror where it almost seems like it's practical effects, like,
yeah, it's close, yeah.
It's so close. They do such a good job of the CGI that really does seem. Like that, just and the noise when someone touches it and just is around it, you can feel it. You feel like you can smell it. It's like really gross. The first season, you know, had the Demogorg, and then the second season had that big beast, the
Mind Flayer, yeah.
And also the dogs. And then this season, it incorporates kind of all of that.
Well, you never really saw the Mind Flayer in season 2.
No, it was just a shape.
You get to see the Mind Flayer,
and you see how it becomes. An actual physical thing.
It's so gross.
And it's disgusting.
But so well done.
Yeah.
See, this is the CGI I'm talking about when it came to Hellboy.
Yeah.
This never took you out of it.
No. I'd say every shot was beautiful. I thought everything was well done. Another thing that they did is they took over an entire old mall. Like, I'm talking about the production did. And resurfaced everything to make it look like a mall from the 80s. All the storefronts
really?
Look exactly the same,
oh,
like the Gap, Claire's, all of that.
Ooh. Did it have that that see-through water block? You know, those, like, blocks for walls you'd see them in, like, McDonald's?
Oh, yeah, all of you guys.
There's a lot of that. You know what I'm talking about.
Yes, and a lot of neon, you know, signs and everything.
That's
80s. It showed how... The mall was the it place to be in the 80s.
It so was.
It was. Everyone was there.
You
families,
have no idea. You have no
kids.
Idea. That's where we
That's,
went.
Yeah.
That's where you went as a kid in the 80s. You went to the mall.
Right. What else are you going to do,
Nothing.
Really? Nothing. So you're inside. The it's climate controls. Yeah. You're safe.
Yes. Back in the day, you could just let your kids go and then come home. Right. Now you let your kids go and they're just gone.
And people are just running around shopping. The economy's just booming. People are happy.
Thanks
Indiana.
A lot, Reagan.
Yeah, it's summer in Indiana. Life's good. And then it's not so good.
They do a lot
of filming in that mall, which I think was a good idea. Because sometimes you think people will leave, like, nope, they can't. They spent a lot of money on that mall, and they did a lot of scenes in that mall.
We're going to use it. Look, we're going to
use this mall a lot. But I thought it was well done. And all the different groupings of everybody, you know, like Steve Harrington and Dustin and everything going on with that. Then, like, Nancy and Jonathan and everything going on in their storyline. Then you have Joyce and Hopper, which was fantastic. And here's something.
And Joyce is Winona Ryder, right?
That's Winona Ryder. And she's great in this series. She's wonderful. And a lot of people had a problem with Jim Hopper this season.
They
thought he was this angry, overbearing, manipulative person.
That's what he was.
Yeah, he's a flawed hero. He's not a perfect person.
He's not at all a good person.
But also... Like, think about the backstory of this guy. He's lost his kid, all that stuff.
Yeah.
Now he's raising a 14-year-old who has superpowers. Like, what? Alone? He's a chief of police? Like, what do you want from this guy?
I know.
Like,
people are so rude when it comes to just there. They're just like,
I want it
to be exactly what I think in my head.
Right.
Well, why don't you write something? I'm not a writer. Then shut up.
Right. Like, just enjoy it, too. Why don't you just enjoy something?
Thank you.
What
you brought up is one of the things I think they did so well in this series that's so difficult to do is all the plot lines... went along well.
Yeah.
Like one didn't detract from the other. When one started to get to you, they dropped the other one. It starts tying them together. That is so difficult to do, I think, when it comes to writing a show like this.
I agree.
Because, like with Jessica Jones, there's one certain character where every time she comes on screen, I'm like, there goes the plot.
Right.
It's just going to grind to a halt.
It's like a black hole of energy.
Right.
Yeah.
And there is none of that.
Why is that? Jessica Jones is bad? Or?
No. Just her lawyer. I can't think of the name. Hogarth. It's just.
Yeah. Even the name. I don't even know anything about this.
Hogarth.
I don't want to watch any Hogarth scenes.
Yeah, I'm out.
Everything that goes on with Hogarth and that doesn't involve Jessica has nothing to do with the plot.
Yeah.
It's like, yes, we get it.
Which
she's
is unfortunate because I love that actress.
No, she's great. Right, Carrie Ann Moss is amazing. Yeah. I'm not saying the role is wrong. It just doesn't match.
It's a totally different show.
It has nothing to do with Jessica Jones.
It does not feel like that at all with Stranger Things. The pacing was perfect. You know, that suspension of belief is there for sure.
Yeah.
Especially if that mall is spot on.
And plus, some of the things are goofy enough to make your willing suspension of disbelief go a little bit further.
Yes.
Just to hear Dustin and the little girl go off
a
little bit.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, well, you know, it's
their
like,
whole
that's
banter.
Not real.
And the they're kids, and they're really great actors. And just the things that they can do emotionally. Millie Bobby Brown, who plays 11... You know, those last couple of scenes, I mean, she's just incredible.
Yeah, she's...
And just watching her character evolve from season one into season three is pretty awesome.
We don't know what she is. Is she people? Or, you know, I mean, seriously, is she a person that's been augmented, or is she something else? We really don't completely know.
We don't know, and how do you live through life with that? You know, that's just...
Can't
I mean,
easy.
She's in Indiana in the 80s, so I guess she can kind of stay under the radar for a long time. But I loved it. I thought it was. I would watch it a fourth time.
So you watched the entire season three times already.
Yes,
that is awesome.
I spent one like the first time watching it, obviously, like sitting down, paying attention to every single thing, and then it's just kind of background all weekend because I pretty much just stayed in my house doing the random thunderstorms all weekend.
Oh, that's I know so many people this 4th of July week, you know, since it came on a Thursday and everybody got a really extra long week, so they're like, what are you going to do?
Nothing. Yeah.
I'm not going anywhere.
Not doing a thing.
Have you heard her rap on Jimmy Fallon?
Yes.
Millie Bobby Brown?
Oh, she's so great.
Is it good?
Yeah.
I have it if
she's
you want to hear
talented.
It. Should I play a little bit?
Sure.
Okay. Because I have not heard her.
Just comes blazing out with the F word. Just...
I gotta turn this dang thing off. Technology.
With the Roots. I mean, she got to sing with the Roots,
I know,
man.
She's 12.
This was on Halloween 2017.
Let's go back to Indiana, circa
1983. Oh, I did see this.
Just for boys in the basement, chilling, playing D&D. There was Lucas, there was Willie, Will, and Dustin, there was a Mike. But one night, Will goes missing while he's riding on his bike. Yikes! That's when they met me alive. I had no hair on my head.
So great. She is awesome, right? That is really cool. So, yeah, that's at realradio.fm. Just click shows and blogs as Angela recaps season 3 of Stranger Things. So do you think out of Angela, 7 Angela replicants, what do you think you would give Stranger Things season 3?
Ooh, I'm going to all the Angelas, all 7 of them.
Wow.
Oh, perfect score.
That's damn.
It's a full Angela. Deck of Angelas right there.
That's a lot of Angelas. So I don't know if that's good or not. Well, that's a lot of Angelas.
Right? 7 would be must-see.
That's must-see. Yeah, that's must-see multiple times.
Oh, it's great. Yeah. Obviously.
And I completely agree with it. I mean, I think this season has just been amazing. If you're a fan of Stranger Things, you're going to freak. you know, because it's just so good. It takes a story, it propels it forward, it makes it bigger, everything has more weight to it. You know,
it's one of those shows that now we're on the 3rd season, and I'm always scared. Like, season 2, I was like, oh, I hope they stick the landing. I hope they do a good job with this. I hope they don't screw it up. That first season was so delicious and delectable from, like, beginning to end. Delicious. Please don't touch it. And then, like, season 2 is really good, introducing Billy and what he goes through in season 3.
I hate
3
Max.
Awesome.
I hate Max.
You don't like Max?
I hate Max.
She's all right.
I hate her. not the actress, but the character. Right.
Can you give me one spoiler?
Yeah.
You don't have to actually verbally say it. You can just, like, indicate non-verbally.
Okay.
Does Billy get it on with what's-his-name's mom?
Oh, she's thinking about it. She's thinking about answering.
That's a great
Mrs.
question.
Wheeler.
That's a great question,
that
man.
That is a really good question.
She's a hottie. But the tension between those two is pretty great, though. They do a good job with that.
And they also show how absolutely awkward 80s bathing suits were.
Yeah.
The cut and just not right.
No.
It's just not right. They didn't know what they were doing.
She's wearing like a Barbie costume.
Yeah, it's weird.
Yeah, strange.
And also, this is during the era of the really short 80s gym shorts, right?
Oh, yeah. And hiked up.
Mm.
Short and hiked up.
Yeah.
You know, which is a bad combo,
Jesus.
Especially with those weird, scary Mike legs. They're the scariest thing, man. They're
look like something out of HP. With this kid's
wait until you see his legs, man. It's like something out of HP Lovecraft. It was like Narfalep running around or something.
Very
it's weird.
Long and lean.
Yeah.
He's got spindly legs.
Spindly.
Oh, wait. They're creepy.
Yeah, gamer legs.
Yes.
Well, thank you, Angela, for that. Coming up. Coming up, Kaz is going to tell us all about the Lord of the Rings Amazon TV show in pre-production.
Yes.
You're listening to First Hits on Real Radio 104.1.
Yes to the lilting sounds of dogs singing the Beatles. Welcome back to Fort Fritz on Real Radio 104.1 FM. I'm Mandaddy. Over there is our host, Fritz.
Hi.
Over there is Angela.
Hello.
And right next to me is Kaz.
Oh, hi.
And so, Kaz, you want to tell us something about what's going on with Lord of the Rings, because evidently they're not done milking that cow.
No, I mean, you could never be, right? There's thousands of years of lore of, you know, Tolkien strangeness out there, so why not? Like, just keep it going.
And one ring.
To bind them all.
One ring of power, right?
Yeah, there's other rings.
There's other rings, yeah.
Because it is Lord of the Rings.
This is true. There's many rings.
It's only one ring that actually matters. And of course,
it's one a thumb ring, because those are weird. Thumb rings are weird.
Well, that one ring always just like the one ring.
A pinky ring or a thumb ring.
I think it goes on the thumb, right? Thumb
ring? No, I think...
Depends upon how big your finger is.
I think it goes on your index finger.
Index finger.
At least that's what Frodo does. Everyone wears the rings different places. You know?
Didn't
Sauron have it on the thumb?
Can it be like a toe ring?
Sauron seems like a toe ring.
A toe ring would be really more difficult if like someone's chasing and you want to turn invisible. You just start hopping and put a toe ring on. You'll never find me. Hold on.
It'd be way more sexy.
Just a left footprint over and over and over again. Where the hell did that bastard go?
Back in 2017, apparently, the deal was struck to the tune of $250 million.
Ooh!
And it is apparently slated to be 5 seasons, at least 5 seasons.
What? Already?
Wow. Renewal, yeah.
What?
It's a lot of material.
That's
so they're starting with, it's interesting because they are, the initial leaks, I guess, around it hinted that it was going to be centered around a young Aragorn, or centered in Aragorn's past. But it has since been updated that it is actually going to take place during the Second Age, which is thousands and thousands of years before any of the actual characters of the movies actually took place. Okay. Right.
So is this like even before Hobbit?
Correct. Yeah, this is way
like
back.
Silmarillion. This is like the Silmarillion type stuff.
Silmarillion.
The Silmarillion. That's the prequel to The Hobbit.
Silmarillion.
That's an actual novel?
Yeah, the Silmarillion. S-I-L-M-A-R-R-I-L-O-N?
Is Gandalf?
It's like a lore compendium kind of thing, right? Or is it like an actual story?
No, it's an actual thing that J.R.R. Tolkien came out with. It's
Is it like, it's not like the tale of someone. It's like a lore compendium. Like, this country had this. The elves, this elven dude did this thing.
I never read it, so I'm not sure. Okay. I was a fan of the band Marillion, so that's why I knew.
Oh, nice.
Marillion. So, like I said, five seasons going to take place during the Second Age, or the Age of Numenor, and I'm sure I'm probably pronouncing that. Numenor.
Numenor.
Around the time that the... Morgoth was banished to the west. Apparently, it was like around the time of the Second Age. So this is going to take place.
Deep dive.
Yeah, they actually did this cool release over Twitter where they did the One Ring to Rule Them, One Ring to Find Them poem. I guess released it as a series of tweets where they showed a blank map, and with each new tweet, they kind of filled in a little bit more of the map to let you know it was going to be taking place in this certain area during the Second Age or whatever. So. Very cool nerd stuff, and I'm excited to get some more Lord of the Rings content. That'd be cool. See if they're able to.
Sure.
I think it's interesting to go from such a high budget, high expectation, you know, series of movies to something that probably isn't going to have a similar kind of budget for that. So,
But did you read the books?
I did. Yes.
Okay. And what are your thoughts on the first three movies versus the Hobbit movies?
The Hobbit had a bunch of stuff that I didn't get because I didn't read the
Silmarillion.
Why are you getting so mad, man, Daddy?
Just the way he's saying it, looking at me right in my face.
He already has my nerd card. Like, what else are you going to take from me?
You're
like... So, I thought the movies went, they flowed. Fine. It was still something that, you know, you get to the end of like a 2.5 hour long movie and it kind of just ended. There wasn't a lot of nice, clean places to end and begin those, but it was fine. And then The Hobbit seemed like it kind of stretched a small amount of content into something larger, but they pumped it up with stuff from the Silmarillion. But it was, they were both enjoyable. That's what I'm saying. The world is enjoyable. The cast is enjoyable. Apparently, they're going to be filming in New Zealand again, so a lot of like similar like locales.
And, Mount Doom, is it?
Mount Doom.
I've been there. Saw it.
Been to Mount Doom?
Yeah.
Did you walk there?
I did.
See?
That's the only way you can go.
Oh.
You can't, like, call those eagles.
I know. They have these eagles that can just fly. Yeah. No, you got to do the walking.
No.
So,
Shadowfax. Where are Shadowfax? We need Shadowfax.
Apparently supposed to get more updates on this later this year, but the initial release date was supposed to be in 2020, around fall of 2020. So.
Oh, that's next year. Points?
Correct. Nice.
Time.
He's so good at time. He's so good at time.
You looked at a calendar, didn't you?
I did. I'm sorry. All right. I'll
bring it back. First few episodes are going to be directed by J.A. Bayona.
Oh, J.J.
Who does? Who directed Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom.
Ugh.
Ooh. That was one word review by Angela right there.
Terrible movie. I'll never, ever, ever watch that movie.
That was the latest one?
Yes.
It did have some issues, didn't it?
Awful.
It did have some issues.
Oh, that was the one that was very sad. Yes.
Sad dinosaurs.
Hey, let's watch all these dinosaurs die in front of your eyes.
Legit cried in the movie theater at a Jurassic Park movie. I was really mad about it.
You can watch people get killed all day long. You kill a CGI dinosaur.
Awful.
Tears.
They milked it. It was terrible.
And they also, like, they're always going to make it make, like, a really terrible noise, too. Like,
just screaming.
Yeah,
no,
nobody wants that. So
this guy, I'm so excited for Lord of the Rings.
J.A. Bayona, which I think harkens back to the
J. Bayona. Bayona.
Exactly, thank you. Someone's on my level.
J. Bayona.
Star Trek IV writers J.D. Payne and Patrick McKay will serve as co-showrunners. I don't know who these people are. You guys are more
good on them. I don't
never
know.
Heard of them.
No?
Nope.
Okay, so this is going in. We're going in blind on this one. We're going to stay tentative
We're
with
going
any
in
beard
live.
Poles or replicant creation. So we'll see. But I'm excited.
Yeah, definitely.
Well, I'll be honest. I didn't know who the creators of Game of Thrones, the show, I didn't know who they were before they did that.
Interestingly enough, co-executive producer Brian Cogman on Game of Thrones is serving as a consultant on the show.
All right.
To kind of help out, I guess.
Help them out.
And it has a little side about him. He's apparently David Benioff's assistant before he actually got to write a few of the episodes that then went on the show.
Oh, wow.
Kaz, were you a big Lord of the Rings fan, movies or books? Or
definitely more books. Like, I had read the books before movies were even thought of happening. I actually remember I did The Hobbit. The Hobbit was one of the first times that they gave us like assigned reading in class, and I just banged through like 8 more chapters and was like, yo, like, I'm past that. We need to talk about this like new thing that's happening in the mountain, and you need to tell me about that. But yeah, no, I like the series. It kind of spurred my initial kind of love of the fantasy genre, so I'm be interested to see more about that.
Well, that's nice. So no beard pulls, no replicants. We're just hoping and waiting.
Hoping and a prayer.
Hoping, yeah. You got a lot of hopes on that one. So right now it's time for us to do a little thing called the checkout. We let you know things that we think that you should check out. Fritz, what would you like us to check out?
Oh, boy, I don't know. There's nothing to check out.
No. Everything is doom.
Womp, womp.
Yeah,
womp, womp.
I mean, I don't, I can't tell you anything.
Okay, I'll throw. Angela, what would you like us to check out?
You guys know about the new, Cat Cafe downtown?
It is downtown, right?
Yes.
Like, is on Robinson, or?
It was.
It was supposed to be there, I thought.
At 360 State Lane.
Huh. Okay.
I don't know where that is.
I think it's a little off of downtown.
Yes.
Then.
Yeah. It's downtown adjacent.
Yeah, because, I mean, being right there on Orange Avenue or something like that would be horrible.
Well, they had an original location, and then that it just didn't work out for them, so they reopened this new one, and they're definitely on their way. It's called the Kitty Beautiful, a cat cafe. I know. How great is that? City Beautiful, Orlando, Kitty Beautiful. I'm really proud of them. I'm not sure when the exact opening date is, but they're going to have coffee and cats, and that is the best.
Nice.
That is the best.
What do you have for us to check out there, Kaz?
Just a little like weird aside tidbit thing I saw. Apparently, they're making another Saw movie, which, ugh, I'm tired of Saw movies.
But,
who cares anymore?
Who's in it?
Two interesting cast announcements. Chris Rock was one of them, and Samuel L. Jackson are apparently going to be in the new Saw.
No, Chris Rock is actually, I think he's part of the writing and directing crew, too.
Really?
Yeah, he's like really involved with it, and that's how they got Samuel L. Jackson to be a part of it, is because Chris Rock is like one of the people that's helping reboot the franchise. I know!
All right.
I'm all about it.
That's weird.
But
check that out.
That's what you want to check out? What I would like you to check out is if you have Xbox Live, one of the games, free games for the month is called Inside. Very cool platformer. Very similar to Limbo, but it's very dark and you don't know what's going on. You're just trying to figure out what's going on in this messed up factory with pigs with worms coming out of them and dogs chasing you. It's a lot of
fun.
So
like a normal pig factory.
Basically, that's how it always is.
Yeah.
And, of course, please check out my trivia nights. I host trivia at Orlando Brewing on 1st, 3rd, and 5th, if there is one, Mondays at 7 o'clock at Orlando Brewing. I'm Tuesdays at Lucky's Market from 5 to 7 in Vineland. And, of course, on Thursday nights, 7 o'clock, I am at Cheers Altamont. Great drink specials, dog-friendly porch. Come on out and check it out. Fritz, you know, you're usually a nice guy. You're very comfortable. You're very a giving individual. But right now, I want you to assert yourself. It's time to get all these people out of Fort Fritz. Fritz, get these people out of Fort Fritz.
Please get out of my house.
You've been listening to Fort Fritz, Real Radio 104.1.
Until next time, pleasant dreams.